So, I think I can show you this in a short term, in a short live demo. I hope it will work out. So I have here a directory where several files are laid down. I won't take all of them. These are several Puppet recipes or manifests, some LDAP files I won't need for today, but the central cap file, and we can show this one. Where at least there are documented the statements I already explained, and then you can execute Capistrano by using just the binary, and a very nice one is the capital T, because then Capistrano goes through your cap file in this directory and shows the several tasks that are in there, and also describes them by the statement desk you probably have seen in the cap file before. And yeah, as the help also explains, you can also do an cap with a small e, and then you get some more documentation if the author has laid them down. So the easy thing is just Puppet no-op. I can execute this as an example. This will connect to a VM I have running here on my laptop and try to upload a test manifest and then try to execute the Puppet one. So on this machine, Puppet isn't installed yet, and I get back this nice red error messages, and I hopefully can fix them by the task setup Puppet. And depending on how the VLAN, the WLAN works, all the stuff is executed well and Puppet will be installed. You probably have seen, may have seen before that one task of Capistrano was also to run an apt-get update. So there were lots of messages now here. And so now Puppet should be installed if it all worked. I think it has. And then we can do a first Puppet run, which is executed with no op, so the test recipe, test manifest isn't executed. So it's quite a verbose solution. I have to admit that, but it's easy to apply and it's easy to set up in my opinion. So let's just check back. Yeah. As I said, combination of both is a nearby idea because both come from the Ruby environment, and someone who knows Ruby well can deal with this very easy. It can be easy set up just by using the corresponding Ruby module, and enables just a kind of Puppet solo on this space. So you don't have to use the master environment. You just care about your Puppet manifests, and you copy them over and run them, and then you can recycle them again for another one. As you have seen, Capistrano opens the SSH connection there, applies the task and recipes on the configured hosts. And so we have a basic groundwork to set up this Puppet recipes. The roles help there additionally to distinct between different environments and between different setups, giving some namespace there. This is also already something that Capistrano has built in when using namespaces to cover some more advanced environments. Yeah. Okay, I already showed you this, but I just will get over for some more. What you also can do is do a cap invoke. So if you just want to fetch some information from the host, you can just send over some commands, which will be executed directly. So something more. I'm going to take a look again. I don't have this thing. Yeah. Let's take another one. Maybe some with some less verbosity. I can execute capital T again and can set up the external login here. Oh, small typo, can be fixed. So, this is a standard one, and we just copied over the xlogin manifest where we have all the information in there for installing another user on the remote machine and already deploying there the authorized key via this manifest. Okay. There are some more functionalities because you also can stream log files back, which can be useful if you don't if you want to save some information from the Puppet runs, etc. pp. And yeah, the Puppet apply we already have seen, so I will go over to the next slide. This is another example for the checkmk agent, where we just again copy over with the upload functionality of Capistrano the checkmp file, run puppet apply, and yeah, the logic itself, this is why I want to present this slide, is the logic itself about how checkmk should behave and should be configured is not in the Capistrano file, but it's in the puppet recipes, obviously. Yeah, short summary of advantages. I think it's an easy installation path. It's an easy control of deployments, also fitting to the criteria I presented at the beginning of the talk. It's really a tool that helps with ad hoc setups and doing things directly, not really regularly, but because you see, if you want to do this every hour or every day, you have to write ugly cron jobs. So this is really not the solution for this environment. This is clear. The description of the configuration allows for granular deployments, so I think this can be really extended in a way that it helps with even more complex setups. No additional services have to be activated or installed. There is also no Puppet running on the host. You have to install Puppet, okay, that's a given, but you don't have to run the Puppet agent daemon, because it's executed manually, and you have the advantage that you can use your secure connections using SSH with well-known and established permissions and access control, as it's already out there. So I think you already saw that there are some disadvantages in Capistrano and Puppet 2, especially because you have to copy over your manifests again and again, and you have to take care that all of your manifests are there before you start your Puppet run. So there's some more to it if you do some research on the internet, because it's not us that had the first idea to do this. So there is an extension, a Ruby gem, that can be used when going into Capistrano and Puppet, which is called supply drop. This is a thing we now use more and more, because it helps to simplify the process again. Supply drop has several tasks integrated in some Ruby libraries. For example, the puppet apply can be run directly, so you don't have to write it there in your cap file separately, but it's laid down in the library supply drop and installed on your local Ruby installation. So you then execute like this one, cap puppet apply, and this will take care automatically of connecting via SSH and running puppet apply on the remote host. Same goes for puppet no op. Just as I showed you in the demo before, this would go just over, and you don't have to write a separate task in Capistrano to do this. It's already there, delivered by the supply drop gem. And the nice thing is that they built rsync into the libraries, so you only have to lay out the files you need and then execute in supply trope async, and so all your recipes will be copied over to the reward machine and then executed, which helps a lot to make this easier. Unfortunately, the supply trope extension does not tidy up itself. So you have, if you want a really clean host machine on which the puppet manifests are applied, you have to do some RM commands or some recipe housekeeping if you want this, if you have to really keep the target machines clean. It also has some more functionality for staging environments, so if you have this requirement, take a look into this extension. I really can recommend it at this point. So, this is so far for CapusTrainer and Puppet. I think it's not really a complex thing, it's just another alternative to the requirements I laid out before. And that's also the reason why I want to finish the talk with some more slides about other tools that are out there that might fulfill these requirements. Namely, this approach of an admin workstation that works as control station versus a master concept. This is the thing I'm talking about. I'm also picking up some kind of the talk of about Ansible that took place earlier today, where the same arguments were put out there. I at least think that key in all cases is a good working versioning control beneath it as basic for this decentral configuration management, because you have to have this version controlling system as kind of help to distinct between environments, to distinct between stages, to be able to create branches, to help you to set up the real environment in the files at least. A general recommendation is something I won't do at this place. I think everybody has to do some research at least, or try it yourself. I think it's a matter of some minutes to get CapusTrainer running on your machine or something else. So just try it out, and you will really see really fast if it's working for you or if you think of it as too complicated or something like this. Some other tools that came to mind when thinking about the solution would be Fabric, which is some kind of CapusTrainer for Pythonists. So if you are in the Python world, Fabric should be something you know. It's a similar approach, taking care about deployments and stuff, copying things over SSH. Again, it's the same concept here. You also can find several integration efforts that took place with Puppet, where at least in the Fabric libraries, connections to Puppet runs are made. Otherwise, at the start, if you really want to, for example, incorporate it in your Python scripts you already have, you just have to import the Fabric API like I laid down here on the slide, and then do the manual run as similar to the CapusTrainer at this place. So if you're more in the Chef environment, I know there's Chef Solo, and there are several ideas behind it, how you can use Chef in such an environment. But there's also comparable to the one I showed for Puppet, to the supply trope one, there is Iron Chef. You can find it on GitHub. Which is similar on this with the solution. It works not that different. If you try it out, you see that it lays down a complete directory structure for your project that fits to the Chef manifests and to the Chef recipes. This could be from help too. And then it's the same as I already showed you. But instead of doing some cap puppet, no op, cap puppet apply, cap puppet whatever, you just can do cap chef bootstrap, for example, to install chef, and so on and so on. So you have several possibilities there that you can incorporate in your solution. So, and at last, I already mentioned it, when looking at the solution. After all, It is using SSH as transport medium. It is writing down your configuration in a somehow well-formatted style so then that everybody can understand and read it. And it's about taking care of your configuration. And so it's obvious that also Ansible would be a solution here because it fits to all this requirements. I don't know if you heard the talk from Jean-Claude Miens this afternoon. If you have missed it, I hope you have a chance to take it on later. I will just do some summary. It's written in Python on the tool itself, and the big difference, and this is also the one that led us to not choose Ansible in our environments. You have to document or write down the configurations in YAML files instead of the DSL ones. And that was an approach that the current people didn't like that well. Sometimes it's also a matter of taste. It's just a very different style. Also, it's a question about how many Puppet recipes have you already done? How many YAML playbooks have you already written? How many things can you reuse or whatever? And so it's a decision of everybody's own to which way to go. But I think from the bare requirements, Ansible could be a good solution at this point too. Push mechanism, as I already mentioned, is here the default. Pull possible in doing some extra work. And the rest is quite obvious at this point. Using SSH here is the basis for all the deployment tasks over the network. So just let me sum up again. I think the content showed that testing or trying out and learning of these tools is really worthwhile, even if you only have smaller environments that you want to configure automatically, because you don't have the initial effort to build up a Puppet master to take care about certificate management between Puppet agent and Puppet master. You don't have to take care where to put the Puppet master, etc. pp. You only can write down your manifests, recipes, or you can try some out which are out there on Puppet Forge or other sources. And you get running in a very fast pace, in my opinion. So the effort is really worth it to look at it, and especially for cases where this central management is not the desired one. The advantages, at least, that exist. You have the high reusability of the manifests. You have a good documentation source for your data center because it's all laid down in the configuration files of Puppet or Chef or whatever. You can restore your environment much faster if you have this documented in this way. And another thing is also that by documenting and writing all this manifest recipes for your environment, you also prevent this typical silo thing, so everyone only looks at this at his own area. The database people only look at the database. Network people only look at the network. The server people or virtualization people don't only look at the on the virtualization side of the data center. But if you incorporate such a tool and make the usage mandatory, you can bring all these people together and so enhance your infrastructure. As far as I'm thinking there. I think that's all I have to say for now, for the summary. I hope you could follow me on my presentation, and I think we have some time more for questions now. Thank you. I have to repeat the question. the question was how you would get feedback from Capistrano. It's running locally on your machine, as I did right now, and the feedback is getting streamed back over the network while executing it. You can go into the cap file and extend just the list that is there. Do you have no? That's a recipe. I go into the cap file. Here you have an example where many machines are put down, and it's the list above where some more machines are shown. And you also can group them, and at least how these machines come into the cap file, you kind of on your own. If you have a source for this, you can use this to generate some lists, or there are different possibilities at this place. More questions? Okay.